Welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, today we are here discussing the hottest topic really of this year, I would say, the corona vaccine. How close are we to getting a vaccine? When will be the rollout? And of course, you know, we've heard about the Pfizer vaccine that is already going to be rolled out in the UK. But where does India stand? There are a whole lot of options to choose from. We have, of course, there's a Russian vaccine that is there. We have got our own indigenous vaccines. Also, Bharat Biotech is making the Covaxin. We're also in talks with Oxford AstraZeneca to the Serum Institute plans to roll out a version of that over here. So to discuss the rollout of the vaccines, to also to where we stand regarding COVID, you know, we've been hearing this is the second wave. Some people say third wave. The winter is going to be really cruel. So in terms of that, where are we placed? What are the best options in terms of cures? Also is something I'm going to be discussing. I have joining me a panel of experts and doctors. I have Dr. Monica Mahajan. She's a general physician at the Max Super Speciality Hospital. Dr. Harsh Mahajan, he is a chief radiologist and the founder of Mahajan Imaging. But more importantly, he's also been working with FICCI and other institutes in terms of planning a vaccine rollout. I have Dr. Gopi Khilnani. He is from the PSRI hospital and he's also the former head of pulmonology at AIIMS. And of course, Amya Paleja, he is a researcher at the Life Sciences Policy at the Takshashila Institute that is also working on vaccine deployment. Dr. Khilnani, first of all, I'm going to ask you the tough question. Which of the vaccines do you think is the best place for India?
We need to understand, you know, what are these vaccines all about, like, and what is the success rate? So the Pfizer is claiming a success rate of 90% to 95%, and the Oxford vaccine by AstraZeneca is claiming a success of anything more than 70% up to 90%, whereas Bharat Serum, that is the Covaxin, which is at a very advanced stage, they claim the success of something like 60% or 50 to 60%. So as far as India is concerned, we cannot compare India to United Kingdom or United States. And we also should understand that India is one of the biggest manufacturer of vaccines, not only today, for a very long time. So as far as the Pfizer vaccine goes, although it is, they have done a phase 3 trials, the success rate is very high. The downside is that it requires to be stored at minimum minus 70, up to 96, minus 96. And when I was in AIIMS, you know, we used to fight to have one fridge of minus 70 to do our research. That was so difficult to achieve. What I want to say that only the high-end research institutions are having refrigerators with the minus 70 facility. So to my mind, the Pfizer vaccine cannot be used for an Indian setting, because if it is not stored properly, one, that it loses value, and it may be, instead of benefit, can be harmful to the patient. Between the AstraZeneca, that is Oxford vaccine, and the Covaxin, I would think that there's nothing to choose. You know, the phase 3 trial looks at the efficacy. We have not yet tested the effectiveness. And there's a technical difference between efficacy and effectiveness. Efficacy is determined at the experimental level. That is what is going on. Like Covaxin trial has 25 centers with 20,000 volunteers to be tested. But actually the effectiveness will come when actually you give it, and over the months and years you see what is the difference in the transmission, what is the level of immunity in the community.
But we don't have that luxury right now, right?
No, luxury we don't have. So what I'm saying, that beggars may not be choosers. So therefore, whether it is Pfizer vaccine or whether it's Covaxin or it's Astra vaccine, whichever comes first, whichever is storable, whichever is doable to the periphery of this country, should be good for us. Thank you.
This is like a race, Monica, you know, the fastest finger first. But, you know, we also are a little worried about the, you know, the I don't know the right word, efficacy or safety. I'll just go with just for the layman's terms. How do we figure that one out?
So Priya, initially all the vaccines had proclaimed that they have 90% plus efficacy, whether it was 95% with Pfizer BioNTech or whether it was 94-95% with Moderna. And similarly, AstraZeneca had claimed similar efficacy rates. But then AstraZeneca got into a little bit of a glitch because there was a controversy with the half dosing in some of the volunteers that happened. And what was found that AstraZeneca claimed that it was more of serendipity and just by luck that they had used half a dose, whereas Oxford University said that it had been deliberately done. Now, with those, since the whole efficacy runs on trust factor, so the lot of trust factor went out of that Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, and the share value of AstraZeneca, the trust factor of AstraZeneca went down. But at the same time, what Dr. Khilani rightly pointed out is that we are a resource crunch country. The Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine both require storage at very, very low temperatures of minus 70 degrees Celsius. And in a country like ours, to maintain that cold chain and to distribute those vaccines would be virtually impossible. So from that point of view, the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is now with Serum Institute in India, still is our best bet because it can be stored in a refrigerator, easily transported, and cost-wise also, it is the cheapest out of all the vaccines that are available. So probably our best bet would still be in terms of the Serum Institute AstraZeneca co-formulation. At the same time, we can't write off Bharat Biotech. They are doing a good job as far as the third phase trials are concerned. Zydus, the data is still not out, so we really don't know how their vaccine fares. But a close contender in the race is also Sputnik V. Mm. The results for Sputnik V are very good, and now Dr. Reddy's and some other people are running trials of Sputnik V in our country as well, and it is again a viral vector vaccine with very good efficacy rates. So I think Sputnik V should also be considered in India as far as the vaccine options are concerned. So my bet for India would be in terms of the Serum Institute AstraZeneca, the Bharat Biotech, and Sputnik V, these three.
Okay, very well articulated. Before I go to Dr. Harsh, one more quick question for you, Monica. There's also been another controversy on the AstraZeneca regarding, you know, there's been one of the trials has said that, you know, one of the patients has claimed to have some neurological problems, some problems as the offset of trials. Of course, later on, they tried to say, no, this is not it. Do we believe it? Because that trust factor also comes in over here also. You know, we're not a little unsure as to, is it a cover-up or actually that patient was not affected by the vaccine?
So Priya, in every vaccine trial in patients, we do have severe adverse reactions. It's not just with AstraZeneca. It is known to happen with practically every vaccine, whether it is the rabies vaccine or whether it is in terms of any other vaccine. Vaccines are known to cause adverse events. Now, okay. AstraZeneca vaccine had caused association with transverse myelitis in a few trial patients earlier on also. But in this particular person who's volunteered for AstraZeneca vaccine, it is a little dubious because this person had coexisting factors. He did have a vitamin B12 deficiency as per the doctor's claims, and he also had some encephalopathy related to a connective tissue disorder. So A, he was not a very good choice to be a volunteer in the vaccine trial in the first place, and B, we cannot implicate the vaccine till we have a clear-cut association between the vaccine and what happened to this person. So we really can't be able to comment that this is purely vaccine-related. But taking that with a pinch of salt, every vaccine is known to have a minuscule population showing adverse events. So even if any of these vaccine candidates does show adverse events in a very, very tiny percentage of population, that still does not negate the fact that we do need vaccines and we need mass vaccination to happen. So it's not just AstraZeneca. I'm pretty sure in the trials with the other vaccines also, there would have been adverse events. It's just that in terms of the publicity factor, what vaccine gets maligned more than the others. But adverse events happen with every vaccine on earth.
Okay. Dr. Mahajan, your take on which vaccine is really best suited for India, or rather, you know, given the fact that which one should we risk the most?
See, Priya, there's not going to be just one vaccine.
Okay.
We are going to have a basket of vaccines, and all of them will be used. Because even the production capacity of any one vaccine in India or globally is going to be limited. And hence, you know, there are currently about 8 candidates that are in the race in India. 3 of them we know very, very well, and they've been already talked about. If you talk about the capacity of production in India, pre-COVID, we were making about 3 billion doses a year, out of which about 1 billion were for use in India and 2 billion were being exported. So really when Dr. Kilnani said beggars can't be choosers, in the vaccine field, India is not a beggar. In fact, we will be producing for the rest of the world as well. Now, if we look at the candidates that are currently there, I think at the forefront, because the phase 3 trial is nearly complete, is the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is being manufactured by a Serum Institute in Pune. And they've been manufacturing it, taking the risk, since July. And we will have about 200 million doses by end of December ready to be vaccinated. And they are capable of manufacturing about 800 million doses a year of this vaccine. Bharat Biotech can do anything between 300. Currently, their capacity is 300 million a year. They can ramp it up, they say, to 500 million. And Zydus can manufacture about 100 million. Now, when we talk about the AstraZeneca vaccine, out of the 800 million which will be produced in India, you know, we are duty bound to give 400 million to the vaccine consortium, which will go to low and middle income countries. So we have 400 million left with us, 300 million from Bharat Biotech, 100 million from Zydus. So we have 800 million or 80 crore doses with us at the maximum level next year, which each vaccine is to be injected twice. And so we will be able to inject about 40 crore of our population in the next year. And then we have this 200 million already manufactured. So we will be able to do possibly about 50 crore people if all goes well. If, you know, the manufacturing goes well, we have the vials, we have, you know, the cold chain set up, even 2 to 8 degrees. I mean, it may seem that, oh, wo to fridge mein rakh denge. But then, you know, these are huge volumes and they have to be preserved. They have to be taken. They have to be taken to the site of injection. And so I'm sure Amey will shed more light on that. But if all goes well, we should be able to vaccinate 40 to 50 crore of our population. Then let me take this forward. How many do we need to inject for us to obtain herd immunity? Herd immunity is that it is said that if between 60 to 70% of a geographical population gets injected, then you may not need to inject the rest of the population because the pandemic will die away. There'll be so few people left to transmit that it'll die away. So with 40 crores in 1 year, 40 crores in year two, 80 crore of the vaccine vaccination available to people, we would be able to vaccinate about 60% of our population and hopefully by end of year two achieve herd immunity. Of course, in this we are not calculating or adding those who have already been infected, because that would be you know, that's a figure we still don't know, because there are the symptomatic figures we do know, and those who came positive on the test, and those who never came for testing and were asymptomatic. So that's another large chunk. So hopefully with 60%, we should be able to achieve herd immunity and achieve this in 2 years. So it's not going to happen in 3 months, 6 months. We still have to continue our behavior, the COVID behavior, for many more months and years.
Once at least. Amey, what is the, you know, you've been also in discussions in terms of the vaccine deployment. Can you share with us, you know, what does it look like? What are the plans?
Yeah, so right now, I think there's very little known from what the government is planning to do. We just know that they probably, you know, they prioritized all the healthcare workers, and that will be top priority when they come to vaccinating people. But beyond that, there's very little that we know. The thing is that we know that, you know, there are some tie-ups that are happening in the background, but nothing is clear yet. So that's something, you know, that we would like more clarity on. like Dr. Hutch said, that this will probably go on for 2 years or maybe longer. And that is something that, something that is a matter of concern, because we don't really know how long the immunity will last after the vaccine. So Moderna's come out with some data today or yesterday, and they said that, the immunity will last only for 3 months. So if the immunity lasts only for 3 months, then, you need something immediately after that. So in terms of that, coming to your question that which vaccine is our best bet, I think even if we do the fastest finger first, maybe after 3 months, the guy who comes up with a dose which gives you 6 months immunity or 8 months immunity, and probably just a single dose, he might win the race in the longer run. So let's not just bet on the, the horse that bolts out the first. Let's wait it out. But yeah, we shouldn't be looking at, probably 2 years, I think, is a long period of time. We already have cases where you spent about 8 months doing this. And we should not kind of let go over here and say, okay, the vaccination, what Mr. Poonawalla said, that India will get vaccinated by 2024. I think that's a tremendously long timeline. We should not be waiting for that. A good news, I think, is that there are multiple players, so Bharat Biotech and, probably Dr. Reddy's will come in, Sputnik will come in. But one thing I'd like to point out is that for as much flak mRNA vaccines have received, for their ultra cold requirements, the thing is that mRNA vaccines are very easy to produce, right? They can be produced at scale. You can really vaccinate a large number of people using mRNA vaccines. And from the Indian perspective, the good news is that Genova Biopharma, which is in Pune, is basically making an mRNA vaccine that is stable at 2 to 8 degrees Celsius. So I think that if you are able to sort out your cold chain in the first 3 months or 6 months, and then mRNA vaccine comes in from, say, Genova Biopharma, because they expect their trials to be completed by March. So probably by April, we'll have the data. If they can really, produce mass, and we can vaccinate people en masse, then I think that's the way to go. So let's not just, put all our eggs into serum's basket right now. Just wait it out, see how things go.
I'm glad you shared some piece of good news with us. I'm going to take a short break, but come back and keep this conversation going. So don't go away. Hello and welcome back to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. We are here discussing, of course, what else but COVID vaccines. That is, of course, the hottest topic of this year. Dr. Khilnani, we were discussing, the after effects of COVID vaccine also is something that is worrying a lot of people. That's going to be a big issue to look out for. So what would your advice be on that?
So before doing that, I would like to clarify my comment on beggars are not choosers. I didn't mean that we are beggars in that sense.
What I meant
was that whatever we get first, that should be. Other thing that I want to tell that, Dr. Harsh Mahajan gave a very good mathematics, sitting on a calculator. But I must say, I talked about efficacy and effectiveness. At best, AstraZeneca or Covaxin or other vaccine, the efficacy, even in experimental setup, is 70%. That means if you vaccinate 100 people, 30 will still be susceptible. They will not develop immunity. That factor we have to take into account while calculating that herd immunity will be obtained. None of the organization is claiming that they'll be able to vaccinate everybody in the population in a period of 1 year or 2 years. We are talking about 3 or 4 years. Third is that we still don't know the duration of immunity, in the sense that so far we know even after COVID infection, the antibodies are lasting for a period of 5 months. Beyond that, we really don't know. And what happens after we inject the vaccine? How long the antibodies, so far we know that it lasts for 3 months. Whether it will last for longer, we don't know. I'm not being pessimist. I'm saying that, it takes years to develop vaccine like smallpox or polio. It took decades to develop a vaccine. We have been very fast in developing vaccine. The world scientists must be commended for developing it too fast. I would say too fast. Never in the history of mankind, such a fast vaccine has been developed. But let's not be too fast in inferring that it will change the game. It must be done. But we have to see the effectiveness of it when it comes to it. And I don't see herd immunity developing in the next 2-3 years. If it develops in 2 years, I would be very happy if 70% of the people...
But Spanish flu developed in 2 years. Without a vaccine, it went away. So why are you so...
But no, I'm not pessimist. But do you know that how many crores of people died in Spanish flu? Do you have any idea? 50 to 100 crore people died. And then the world population got reduced by so much percentage. The COVID is not killing so many because we know how to treat it today. At that time, where was the RT-PCR? Who knew what is that flu? What was the treatment for that? How to stop the transmission of the social distancing, all those, and use of masks? This we know now. Spanish flu is no example of a success. It is a Spanish flu example of a human debacle. It is only a history. So I don't think we can take that example. The Spanish flu and lasted for more than 2 years, if you remember.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Actually, Dr. Monica, to bring you in on this, my example of Spanish flu was not really in the terms of that, but the fact that there was no vaccine to counter it, it just went away, whether it was because of herd immunity or whatever reasons. So can the same be hoped for COVID? That was actually the question that I wanted to ask.
Priya, if we talk of herd immunity in COVID, we would be talking of a disaster in the making, because we would be talking of so many millions of people dying in the process of trying to acquire that herd immunity. Okay. So our best bet is still in terms of the vaccination, rather than in terms of people walking in the streets with their masks off, trying to infect as many people as possible and spreading the virus around, what the Trump administration was at one point of time proclaiming, that if we can try and get that sort of herd immunity. But the cost of that herd immunity without the vaccine, in terms of a mob of people walking without a mask and passing on the infection to other people, is lots and lots of human lives lost. So Spanish flu, that kind of herd immunity is what Sir mentioned, that millions of people died. So we don't want to look at that option of herd immunity without considering the option of vaccine. And so we are so much better equipped now, that why should we not give the benefit of the vaccine to majority of the population? Again, I would want to make three comments at this point of time. One, that if the vaccine efficacy is 70%, we do not know that out of the 100 people who got infected, which are those 70 who will be protected and which are the 30 who will not be protected. Mm-hmm. So we will still have to practice safe practices in terms of cutting out the spread of the virus, because we don't know whether you're in that 70% or you're in that 30%. Now, the second part is in terms of how frequently will we need to vaccinate, like what was mentioned in terms of the duration of immunity offered by the vaccine. So some vaccines, for example, the influenza vaccine, are given as annual vaccines. So you need to vaccinate people annually for the influenza vaccine to work. Whereas some vaccines offer long-term immunity. So for example, tetanus, you can revaccinate every 10 years and still manage to go around with it. So for this particular vaccine, since it's such a fast track process, we really don't know whether the T and B cells will work for 1 year, or whether they will work for 3 years or 5 years. Who knows? So by the time you finish one cycle of vaccinating people, it may be that the same set of people are now requiring a revaccination. So we don't really know what kind of immunity these vaccines will offer. So apart from the vaccination, the social distancing and behavior practices will still remain the norm for a long period of time, because we don't know whether we will need to do it annually, every 2 years, 3 years. Who knows that? We still really are in very early phases of that vaccination to say how it will work. As far as the other challenges with the community of scientists is concerned, they are working on improving their vaccines. For example, the mRNA vaccines with Moderna and Pfizer are still the safest vaccines. They do not interfere with the genetic human code. So they are safest and easiest to manufacture. So the Pfizer-BioNTech have actually announced that their second batch of vaccines will be such that they can be stored at minus 20 rather than minus 70. So they know the glitches that are there. They are trying to improve on those glitches. But there are too many question marks as far as the vaccines are concerned. The efficacy, we don't know. The duration of immunity that will be offered, we don't know. And what percentage of population will require to be immunized to get a herd immunity, we really don't know that answer. So too many questions which are still unanswered at this point of time. we'll probably only get to know with time, 1 year down the line when you're holding this program, maybe you'll be wiser off in terms of how many doses and how many people.
My need. God, one more year to go. Dr. Margin, quickly, I will last word.
Many more years. I think we are unanimous on that, that it cannot be that, you know, the vaccine has come and so it's all hunky-dory. It is going to take time. Again, like has been said, you know, I showed you a calculation which looked very rosy, but, you know, you have to take into consideration the fact that we still don't know how long the immunity will last. So if the first, those who were, you know, vaccinated in January 2020 and it lasts only 6 months, then they need to be revaccinated. So our calculations go out of the window.
That's
so
true.
Safety mechanism that we have adopted and the change in lifestyle that we have adopted, it'll have to continue for several more years. Don't
it
think that we
say.
Can revert back to the same Bindas lifestyle, carefree, very soon.
Ended the last segment on some good news. Do you have any more good news to end this one?
I would just say that, you know, even if, let's use your example and say Spanish flu did go away in 2 years, right? Irrespective of what the cost was. But if you're looking at it that ways as well, there is still reason to look at the way we are doing the vaccines, developing vaccines at a fast pace, the approvals that will happen very quickly. We need to keep an eye on it. We need to, you know, go through the cycle at least once, because going forward, you know, the risks of such diseases occurring again are very high, right? So SARS is something we've seen before. It was limited to a geographical area. We didn't bother much about it. MERS is something we've seen before. Ebola is something we've seen before. And, you know, these all have been like, you know, warning lights for us, and we've done nothing about it, right? So three epidemics, and we've done nothing about it. It took a SARS-CoV-2 to actually wake everybody up and say, okay, we need to make vaccines really fast. There were vaccines in development for SARS, and then funding dried up for those, and then nothing happened after that. They just went into cold storage. And now we are complaining we don't have cold storage. We don't have any backups, right? So we need to look at it beyond SARS. We need to look at it beyond COVID and say, okay, tomorrow, if this happens again, we are prepared, right? If we need to vaccinate the whole adult world, we are prepared. So let's look at it in that fashion. Let's, you know, drum up our systems and say, okay, this is how we'll tackle this. Let's not wait for another COVID to happen and say, okay, this is how we'll do this. So,
okay, on that note, thank you so much, all of you, for joining in this discussion and for giving us some very valuable takeaways. Thank you. And thank you all for watching this show. Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.